Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to 10th Presbyterian Church. To prepare ourselves for our worship, let me read from Psalm 111. Psalm 111, praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful.
Perishing. It is because Christ has died to save us that we may come here now and worship our Lord. Let me read for our call to worship, Revelation 1. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Stand. Sins together, and if you use in your bulletin the prayer of confession. Let us pray. O God, our Father and King, forgive us for thinking less of you than we ought, for we think your truth too high, your will too hard, and your power too remote, but they are not. We pray that you would resolve our confused minds with your word, redirect our divided wills with your law, restore our troubled consciences with your forgiveness, and revive our anxious hearts with your presence. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us, amen. Our God, our Father and King, we give you thanks for the forgiveness that we have received through our Lord Jesus Christ, for his blood that was shed for us upon the cross. And we now pray for the anointing, the blessing of the Holy Spirit, whom you have sent among us, whom you have sent to dwell within us, praying that by your Spirit we may offer in response to you prayers of thanksgiving, hymns of praise and of reverence, by which we will give to you a sacrifice that is pleasing unto you. For in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Join with me in prayer now. Our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we give you thanks this morning, for you are great and awesome. We thank you, Father, that your greatness has been shown to us in your word. There recorded, we see your great deeds, and we give you thanks, Father, for giving us your word, that word that speaks truth, that word that we can rely upon, that we can look to, that we can trust and know that there is a sure word in the midst, Father, especially in our day, when so many things are unsure, when there are so many doubts, when there are skeptics all around, when we continue to see, Father, those who would undermine your truth, yet you have given us your word and we stand upon it. And we thank you even more that within your word you have revealed to us the way of salvation in your Son, Jesus Christ. That on every page there is found the way in which we ought to come, Father, before you through Christ. And we thank you, Father, that in your word, once again, we can find life eternal. We thank you also for the work of the Holy Spirit. That Spirit, Father, that has inspired the human authors to write and produce this word. That same Spirit that has come to us through the work of your word, Father, to regenerate us and call us your children. And that same Spirit that continues to work to illuminate us, to understand your word more and more. We thank you, Father, for the privilege, even this morning, of hearing your word preached. We pray, Father, that you would give strength and power to our pastor this morning, and that the Spirit would work in and through the word, and that those today who do not know you, who do not know Christ as their Savior, that even this morning, Father, you would call them to yourself, that the Spirit might work in that powerful and unique way. We pray for us also, Father, who know you already, that this morning we would be fed from your word. And again, that your Spirit's work in illuminating us to understand better, we would see and be encouraged by that this morning. We thank you also, Father, that the Spirit is our intercessor, that one who comes, Father, and knows our needs as well and presents them. And we thank you, Father, this morning that we also have the privilege of prayer to come before you as a congregation and to lay before you our requests, knowing that you are a good and gracious God who desires to hear our requests and will answer them according to your perfect time and will. And so we do lift these requests to you. We pray especially for Joe Cerrone and his family as they grieve over the death of his mother. We pray, Father, that you would be very close to this family right now, that you would bring comfort in this time of grief, that you would continue to draw those around them that would support and encourage them, and that they would continue to put their hope in Jesus Christ. We pray for Kate Apple as she recovers from her fall. We pray for healing and full restoration. We ask that you would watch over those caring for her, especially the doctors, and continue, Father, to encourage her spirit as well. We commit to you those in our congregation who are looking for employment, Father. We ask that you would provide for their needs. We ask that you would continue, Father, to encourage them also, and that you would lead those right opportunities to come before them, that they might be able to use their talents to serve, Father, in whatever capacity that you are calling them to be in. We pray for our leaders in this congregation, for our session, our elders, and for the diaconate as they meet this Tuesday night. Father, bless their meeting. Give them wisdom and discernment in the decisions that they will make. Continue, Father, to work through them as they lead us in ministry here at 10th, in this city, and in all the places in which this ministry touches, Father, your people. We pray for Maranatha and for the youth that are laboring, Father, this summer in the various summer camps in the city and the projects that they're involved with. May this be a time, Father, of great edification and encouragement, that as they apply themselves to ministry, that you would continue, Father, to bless their work, that they might see, Father, even now, what a powerful presence you are as you are working with them and through them, Father, this summer. We pray for Acts Fellowship Bible Study and the leaders there. Father, we pray that as they minister to our homeless guests, that this would be a time of great encouragement and a time in which they would see hope, Father, not just physical hope in this world, but more importantly, spiritual hope in the gospel. Father, we also commit to you our global partners. We thank you for their work in other parts of the world. We thank you that we might join with them in partnership through prayer and other means, that even as we live here in the Philadelphia area, we can see and be a part of the work of your gospel in other parts of the world. We pray for Joseph Diaji. We pray for him in his ministry now that he's back in Nigeria. We thank you for your faithfulness to him all the years that he was with us here studying in Philadelphia. We pray that you would bless his teaching, his preaching, his writing, all of the meetings that he's a part of, the bi-weekly retreats that he conducts. And we ask, Father, that you would give him strength and encouragement to continue to preach and to teach. We pray especially for the country of Nigeria that he lives in. We hear so much, Father, of the violence that is a part of that country, and we ask for your peace. We ask especially that you would protect Joseph and his family and continue, Father, again, to be with him in his labors. We pray for Philip and Joy and the language studies that they are part of in Greece, and we ask also, Father, for your blessing upon them and that you would provide all the necessary resources that they need. We pray for many of our partners who are making transitions now, Harvey and Heidi, as they move to Colorado with their children, that they would readjust to life back here in America, that you will provide for them a good home, a good church, a good community there in Colorado. We pray for Scott and Vicky and Crispin and Karen as they settle in their new place in Asia. Again, Father, we know that you will provide for all their needs there as well, that they would be able, Father, to move very quickly to that ministry setting and getting off the ground to the work that you've called them to do. Finally, we pray for Stephen Langford and ask that you would bless his work, Father, in Uganda as he works in an orphanage there. Continue, Father, to be with those that he will touch and be a part of to bring a word of hope and encouragement and to point them again to salvation in Jesus Christ. Once again, Father, we thank you for this morning, and we pray, Father, that you would again hear our requests and answer them according to your perfect time and will. And we trust, Father, in you. We thank you and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to read from the book of 1 Corinthians this morning, in chapter 1. So if you would like to follow along, you can turn to page 952 in the black pew Bible in front of you. This is a passage in which the Apostle Paul is contrasting the wisdom of God with the wisdom of the world. I'm going to read from chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. Listen to what God says. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. This is God's word. Let me welcome you this morning to 10th Church. And if this is your first time here with us, we're glad that you're here. And I imagine you may have some questions and might be curious about why and how we do what we do. And if that's the case, feel free to ask someone sitting next to you, and if that's perhaps not your style, there are welcome cards in the rack in front of you, and I would encourage you to feel free to fill out one of those cards and put any questions you have down, and we will do our best to make sure that we can address those questions and perhaps help you feel even more welcome here at 10th Church in coming weeks. This morning, I want to just give you a few announcements about what's happening here at 10th Church. Even though they're meeting right now, I do want you to know that 10th International Fellowship meets Sunday mornings at 11 o'clock during this worship service, actually, upstairs in Fellowship Hall, which is directly behind me in one flight up. This evening, after the evening service, there is a reception in the room immediately behind me, and it gives you an opportunity to hear about the Liberia short-term missions trip that happened earlier this year. And there will be a short presentation and a time for questions. So if that's of interest to you, that's right after evening worship tonight. Next week, after the 11 o'clock service, there is the Around the World in 80 Minutes luncheon, and our global partners Bill and Debbie will be here to speak to us about their work in East Asia. And on Monday, July 29th, just so you have a chance to register ahead of time, if you're interested, we will be hosting a blood drive. And if you would like to come and do that between 1 o'clock and 6 o'clock p.m., Monday, July 29th, you can register at 10th.org and come and donate blood. Again, I want to welcome you to our worship this morning and hope that you find it to be a place of refuge and refreshment.
Well, we're pleased this morning to administer the sacrament of baptism to five of our covenant children. And coming forward is first of all, John Camerata the third. His parents are John and Amy. Then Asher Elijah Gill and his sister Mira Elizabeth Gill are coming. Their parents are Jeff and Rochelle. Then Lily Anna Morshiser. Her parents are Eric and Mary Lee. And then Caroline Ann Williams. His parents are Jason and Marissa. Let me just say a few words about baptism. As a sacrament, it has been instituted by our Lord Jesus Christ, and it is a sign and a seal. The sign and seal of the gospel, specifically of the covenant of grace that is ours in Jesus Christ, of our engrafting, our union into Christ's body. It signifies the remission of sins and regeneration and our adoption in Christ. The water itself represents two things. One is the cleansing blood of Christ. It cleanses us from our sins, and then also one of them just staring at me, looking at me with a, you know, I'm glad to see that already. You're listening to your minister, okay. The other is the anointing of the Spirit of Christ upon us. And this is a promise that's made both to believers and their children. And baptism itself, water baptism itself does not save. That is the baptism of the Holy Spirit by which he regenerates us. And let me come down and speak to the parents. A word to the parents. I'll come over here. The sacrament of baptism is a sign and a seal that your God presents for you. It is to build your faith, for you to see the promises that are made to your children. It is also something that you do in response, and that you yourself are saying that you will do a number of things for your children. One is to instruct them in the word of the Holy Scriptures. You are also to instruct them in the particular principles of our faith. You are to pray with and for them. And perhaps the most difficult challenge before you is to live lives before them that shows what it is to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Now let me read to you the promises of Scripture for you. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you. Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. And let me ask these questions of you parents. Do you acknowledge your child's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you? Do you claim God's covenant promises in their behalf? And do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for their salvation as you do for your own? Do you now unreservedly dedicate your children to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before them a godly example, that you will pray with and for them, that you will teach them the doctrines of our holy religion, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? Do you? Now, a question for the members of this congregation. Do you, as a congregation, undertake the responsibility of assisting these parents in the Christian nurture of their children? If so, say, we do.
We do.
Let us pray. We do give you praise, our God, for your covenant children, the blessings that you give to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. And we lift up these children before you. We lift up John Cameradam, of Asher Elijah, of Mira Elizabeth, of Liliana and Caroline Ann. We thank you for the physical birth that you have given to them, and look to the spiritual birth that you will grant them in Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. My first child is John Camerata III. They are going to be calling him Jack, by the way. And John is named after his grandfather and, of course, after his father. Thank you. There we go. There we go. Good. And John Camerata III. May the Lord so bless you that you will follow in the faith of your fathers, of John, your father, and of John, your grandfather. John Camerata, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good job. Now we have here Asher Elijah. Asher means happy. Or blessing. And Elijah means the Lord is my God. Asher, may you know the blessing, what it is to be a man whose Savior and Lord is Jesus Christ. Thank you for a moment. Yeah. Asher Elijah Gill, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Good job.
All right. And who do we have here?
Mira.
And this is Mira Elizabeth. Mira means wonderful or peace or prosperous. Elizabeth means God's promise or I am God's daughter. And Mira, as God's daughter, may his promise of salvation that is signified in your baptism bring peace to you throughout your life. Mira Elizabeth Gill, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. Good. And this is Uatu. I'll let you hold on to Lily for a second here. Lily is in the name of the flower. It means purity. And Anna, her second name, means favor or grace. And Anna, may you be one who, by the Holy Spirit, sets an example of faith and purity in your life through your faith in Jesus. There we go. Lily Anna Morshiser, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now we've got here Caroline Ann. Caroline. Now Caroline's, her first name is for her great-great-grandmother. Yeah. And Ann is for the name of her maternal grandmother. Now Caroline, as you honor your grandmothers with your name, may you also honor the three-person God in whose name you are to be baptized. Caroline Ann Williams. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we're going to continue our worship through singing hymn number 411.
Father, as we continue to worship you this morning with our money, we ask that you would make us keenly aware of your kindness to us, that you have been faithful to your word, that you will take care of us. And so, Father, we do pray that you would do that, not just for us or for this church, but for those who don't yet know you, for folks in this city who are disenfranchised, who are hurting, who need to hear the good news. Father, we pray that you would establish the work of this church for your glory, for our good, and for the good of many throughout the city and throughout the world, to the praise of your name. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Draw near, O Lord,
Well, for the last two Sundays, we had been exploring what I call the Gospel of Man. We looked at the Gospel of Man in a couple of perspectives that it presents. One is you might call the Gospel of Law Keeping. And in this type of gospel, what we are taught is that if we do our part in meeting the requirements of God, then we can expect God to do his part in accepting us. The other type of gospel of man is the gospel of the heart, which proclaims there's actually nothing for us to do to win God's acceptance because he already accepts us. And he already accepts us because, well, he looks into our hearts and sees that we are basically good people. Now, in analyzing each form of the gospel of man, I'd reasoned out responses, kind of like this. We looked at law keeping, and though it seems honorable, it inevitably leads to pride, and it turns God into kind of a deal maker. Trusting in the heart might seem good, but however heartening it may seem to say that we have good hearts, ultimately is disheartening. Because in those times of quiet reflection, when we really are honest with ourselves, well, there isn't that good of stuff in there. And we have to kind of hide it and try to make ourselves believe that we're okay. Now, in each case, I think the reasoning was sound. But if you're like me, even for me, such reasoning was not fully satisfying in responding to these false gospels. Because if we know Christ, if we are to find satisfaction, then we need to turn to the cross. And we've been in the midst of a heat wave. I'm sure many of us have been drinking more than our usual share of water. We appreciate not only having water, but when we've been outside, we want cold water. If we've been walking outside, or let's say you've been hiking outside in this kind of weather, and you were to come across a cold stream, you might do a couple of things. One is you drink the water, you take it, put it into your mouth, the water into your mouth. It feels refreshing. But probably you do one other thing as well. You take that water and you just splash it on your face. You're hot, you're weary, maybe even feeling a little bit disoriented. And that splashing of the water kind of just wakes you up, makes you mentally alert. Well, that's what the meditation upon the cross does for us mentally as we regard spiritual matters. Because without the cross, you look at the gospel of man and it can seem rather sensible. For without the cross, the nature of sin diminishes, as well as God's holiness and righteousness, even his mercy and love. Because without the cross, well, without the cross, it makes sense that law keeping, you know, if we work hard enough, will make us acceptable to God. And without the cross, it seems reasonable when we look around and we're basically good people. We're doing the best we can. And we know that God is just kind of a loving God and he wants everybody happy. It's when we come to the cross, it's when we come there and we behold the Word, the Lord's anointed, the Son of Man and Son of God hanging upon a symbol of curse. That's when we begin to ask some questions. What is sin that its horror be so exposed? What is holiness? What is righteousness that would require such a sacrifice? What is love? What is mercy that takes on such suffering? So what do you think the cross is about? Why do we think Jesus died? We must answer, all of us, that question. It is the cross that tells us that religion is not a game. Okay? It tells us that the stakes are real. This unending dialogue about God, however we might conceive him to be, about spirituality, this pleasant talk about our journey of finding God, and that we will never ever end that journey, but we follow it in our own unique ways. It's not a game. We're not discussing a novel or a movie which, when it ends, it allows us to go back to our comfortable homes, holding on to our comfortable perspectives, kind of just getting on with life. The cross makes God personal. Not merely personal for us, but for God. If it's true, he sent his son to die. He paid the price that no human father or mother would ever pay for the sake of anyone. His son, Jesus, gave up glory itself for the purpose of dying for us. What are we going to do with that? Again, what do we think the cross is about? Well, the Apostle Paul understands what most people think about the cross. He's expressing that in his text. He talks about the law keepers when he speaks of the Jews, and the heart followers when he mentions the Gentiles, and that they think it, well, this is what they think of the cross. To the Jews, to the law keepers, it's a stumbling block. Because on that cross must be a law breaker. How else could God allow such a curse to occur to his prophet who was following after him? Now, to the latter, the Gentiles, the cross is just sheer folly. How could a good-hearted God approve of such a travesty? Especially when it's unnecessary. It's unnecessary because he already accepts us. Now, Paul credits both attitudes with foolish pride, whether it's a lawkeeper or a heart follower. Either one, they're thinking that they are wise enough to kind of just figure it out. What is sufficient for God? And the one thing that they know for certain is that a man hanging on the cross cannot be the answer. But it is. This Christ, by man rejected, as Paul says, who is the power and wisdom of God. It is Jesus Christ and him crucified that Paul is determined that this is all that he will proclaim. And it doesn't matter how it sounds to anyone. It is Jesus Christ and his crucifixion that reveals what is true, who God is, what he demands. It is Jesus Christ and him crucified that shines a spotlight on the hearts of men and women, whether or not they desire God's acceptance, whether or not they believe he exists. So again, let's return to these questions that the cross presents to us. What is sin that its horror be so exposed? What is holiness and righteousness that requires such sacrifice? What is love? What is mercy that takes on such suffering? Consider first of all, what is sin? Ye who think of sin but lightly, nor is supposed the evil great, here may view its nature rightly, here its guilt may estimate. Mark the sacrifice appointed, see who bears the awful load. 'Tis the Word, the Lord's anointed, Son of Man and Son of God. Now, I know we have a number of doctors here in the sanctuary, and I suppose doctors, when you do get sick, what you want to know to decide on how serious your illness is, you want to know about the illness and want to know the test results and whatever it is that doctors talk about. Now, for most of us, what we look at is the treatment that we're told we must undergo. So let's say if I go to the emergency room because of heart palpitations, and the resident on duty looks at me, then gives me an aspirin and sends me on my way. I conclude from that my heart must be relatively healthy, must be okay. Now, if instead he tells me, he assures me that he has called the best surgeon for this kind of thing, and that already he is getting the operating room being prepared, I worry. This is serious. It is treatment for my illness, not information about the illness, not how I'm feeling at the moment, how my body feels. It's that treatment that gives me the proper understanding of how seriously to take my body's condition. And so it is with diagnosing sin. Now, the gospel of man takes sin lightly. Those who believe in following the heart, they kind of look around and look at themselves and they say, you know, the heart is basically good. I mean, everybody's human. Everybody to some degree has some faults, but deep down, the heart is healthy. Maybe we need improvement. Maybe we need better education. So we kind of get rid of our prejudices. Or, you know, maybe some people have gone through bad experiences and been mistreated. And, well, they have some therapy. Or get around them a positive environment. That should heal their wounds. Or, you know, if we would just eat better, exercise more. We're not really bad, at least not most of us. Kind of all get along okay. We just need a little bit more help, maybe. Now, those who believe in law-keeping also devalue sin. Okay, they recognize that there is a code of behavior that they need to keep, and they might even think that most people don't keep it. But still, the code, the laws, are not unreachable. Anyone can keep the law well enough if they really wanted to, if they really tried, and then God will accept them. Yes, we have our faults. We have our sins. Maybe we've done some bad things in the past, but we can make up for it, okay, if we try hard enough. Well, we need to look to the cross. And as the hymn says, we need to see who's hanging there. It's the Son of God. Why do you think he is the one who was sent? Why not another prophet? Why not another king like David? Why not even send maybe an angel to handle this stuff? Or if he must send his son, well, why wasn't the ministry of his son not enough? His preaching, his healing. I mean, if education is sufficient to make us righteous enough, why couldn't the teachings of God the Son do the job? If healing from suffering is what is needed to make us better, then why couldn't the miraculous healings, why were they insufficient to change the hearts of those who beheld these healings? Why send the Son? Why send him to the cross? Why was it necessary, as Peter wrote in his epistle in 1 Peter 1, that he needed to be, that we had to be ransomed from sin, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ? Why? Well, maybe sin is more terrible than we realize. Maybe. Maybe what seems like just a lingering cold is really a deadly disease. Maybe what seemed treatable with painkiller will truly kill us without radical measures. Let the cross, not how you feel, not how you've been educated or conditioned, let who is hanging on the cross measure for you how serious your sin is. Then there's a matter of holiness. What is holiness? What is righteousness that requires such sacrifice? Tell me, ye who hear him groaning, was there ever grief like his? Friends through fear his cause disowning, foes insulting his distress, many hands were raised to wound him, none would interpose to save. But the deepest stroke that pierced him was the stroke that justice gave us. It is the cross that impresses upon us reality of terms that mentally, you know, we think we've grasped, we think we understand them, but we really don't. They don't really have a stronghold on us. Yeah, we know that God is holy. We know that God is righteous, that he is just. We consent to that. But it's hard to shake off that stronger image of this kind of old man who is always smiling a little bit. Maybe he has his hands clasped in front of him. Yes, God is righteous, but we kind of think of him more like a judge who, he may strike fear in real criminals, but he passes out treats to children who, you know, children who will be children. And that's what most of us are, you know. Do you think such an encounter with God is what Jesus experienced on the cross when he called out, my God, why have you forsaken me? We look at the cross and we see on his body blood and stripes, and we were filled with compassion. God sees on his son's body the sins of the world, the sins of you and me. And when he sees those sins, he is filled with wrath at such an offense to his holiness and righteousness. Because as Isaiah says, he cannot endure iniquity. And so the steepest stroke that pierced him was the stroke that justice gave. Again, the cross tells us this was not a game. The cross is not a make-believe stage production. Christ took upon himself our sin. He became sin so that the stroke of righteous justice would fall upon him and not upon us. And that stroke of righteous justice is the stroke of God, his Father. Now, does such a concept shock you? Well, it should. It is so shocking that people have tried to explain it away. They said, well, no, the cross must be about something else. And so they said, well, I know. It is about Jesus winning victory over evil forces. Now, that's true. Colossians 2:15 says, he disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. That is, that work he did on the cross. That's true. But it's only part of the truth. The previous verses say this, and you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. The record of debt was the record of our trespasses, and they were removed from us by being nailed on the cross with Jesus. Now, others say, look, here's what the cross is all about. The cross was the means by which God could demonstrate his love for us. That also is true. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Now, but the scripture also says others. John, who wrote John 3:15, also wrote in 1 John 4:10. He says, look, in this is love. Not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son for a purpose. Not just to demonstrate love, but for a purpose. To be the propitiation for our sins. Now, the meaning of propitiation is to turn away wrath. Okay? Well, whose wrath? God's wrath. Why is God angry? Because a holy and righteous God cannot endure iniquity. Now, it's here that I'm supposed to, which normally would take much longer time to explain what is true, to explain the logic of all this, that God, for him to be holy and righteous, and then also to forgive us of our sins, Well, there needed to be some kind of solution, and the atonement of that sin then needed to be made, and it was made through Christ. All of that is true. But again, though we can follow the logic, we still struggle with the reality when we're looking at the cross. Why such measures? Why that cross? Why indeed? Well, maybe like sin, again, holiness and righteousness are concepts we know little about, but not really. We're like Isaiah. You know, when Isaiah, growing up, he's a young man, and he knows, he's taught well about God. He knows God is holy. He knows God is righteous. He knows those things. He knows the whole point of the law is about following a righteous God, that every time these sacrifices are offered, that's all about keeping righteous before a holy God. Even so, that did not prepare him for his encounter with the holy God. When he went into the temple and the vision of God was displayed before him, and he saw God's holiness and righteousness, and it led him to cry out, "Woe is me, for I am lost. For I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Now, we're not given such a vision. We don't have typically, most of us don't have that kind of vision before us, by which we are able to come to grips with God's holiness and righteousness. But we have been given something, if anything, more clear. The Son of God, receiving the stroke that justice gave. That is the just stroke that we ought to have received from the judge who is holy and righteous. So the cross, it gives clarity to us about sin, our sin, gives clarity about holiness and righteousness. And then there is love and mercy. What kind of love is this? What kind of mercy that willingly takes on such suffering? Well, as much as the cross has been able to clarify things, sometimes the cross itself is just a great mystery. Again, as I mentioned, at the cross, the horror of sin is revealed. At the cross, the holiness and righteousness of God is revealed. We now see a mercy and love so profound that it both reveals this love, this mercy, and all the same, making it even more mysterious. Because the cross leaves us with a question. Why would a holy God pay such a costly ransom for an unrighteous people? Did he need us? Well, hardly. He is a self-sufficient God. This is God the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. They don't need anyone. And I mean, if you think he needs something else, well, he has his angels who are holy and righteous. Why then did the righteous and holy God do it? Well, I want you to contrast this gospel of the cross with its mercy with the gospel of man and its so-called love and mercy. Now, according to the gospel of man, God loves us because, well, we proved ourselves worthy of it. Okay, we've done enough. Or because, hey, we're basically good-hearted people. But in the gospel of the cross, what we're taught is that God pays the most precious ransom price to redeem us, whom he knows to have wicked hearts. According to the gospel of man, God is doing nothing more than giving us what we deserve. Basically speaking, God owes us. Okay? He owes us the love and the mercy that he gives to us. The cross reveals love, real love. Love that honors holiness and righteousness. And love that loves the vilest sinner. It is love that makes the costliest sacrifice. And perhaps most important for us, love that can be trusted. It's here at the cross that we have a firm foundation. Here, the refuge of the lost. Christ, the rock of our salvation, his the name of which we boast. Lamb of God for sinners wounded, sacrifice to cancel guilt. None shall ever be confounded who on him their hope have built. It's here at the cross and nowhere else that there is our rock of salvation. Here is the refuge of the lost, that firm foundation upon which we may stand. We don't need to drum up enough confidence in ourselves to make us feel worthy or to keep in favor with God. We do not need to keep laws and rituals in hope that if we do well enough and if we keep it up throughout all of our lives, well, then hopefully we will be acceptable to God. We do not need to repeat to ourselves how basically good we are. I'm building up our self-esteem in order to convince ourselves that we're safe with God. Here at the cross, out of love, the Lamb of God canceled our guilt. If we will now but build our hope on him. So sin, holiness, and righteousness, love, it's at the cross that we find understanding, that we find hope, real hope. Not the hope of wishful thinking, not the hope found on our feeble efforts at law-keeping, not the hope of listening to our ever-shifting hearts. It is hope that rests on the salvation of God, that God has provided. It is a hope that does not try to veil the horror of sin, nor the brightness of holiness and righteousness so that we can feel worthy of God's love. Now again, it's hope that rests fully on the work of the Lamb of God. That rests fully on what has been given freely by God the Father, on what has been offered up freely by God the Son, on what has been offered out of an unfailing, unconditional, steadfast love. And so, Christian, I ask you first, will you not rest in such love? Will you not stand on such a foundation? Do you worry that you have not proved yourself worthy of such sacrifice? I have people come to me regularly saying, Pastor, I must not be a Christian. I don't think I would have committed the sin that I committed or keep struggling with sin. And I look at the cross and I see what Jesus did for me and I see how I'm responding and I'm not worthy enough. Well, of course you're not worthy. Of course you're not able to prove even now that you are worthy enough. It's Christ alone, not your helping him out, that is the foundation of your relationship with God. Now, yes, try to live holy and righteous lives. Yes, seek to please your Heavenly Father, but rest in the work of Christ. Look to the cross. Now, to any who may still hold back, you like the gospel, man. You don't like this gospel that talks about all the time how sinful you are. You don't like being thought of in that way. And, there shouldn't be any place for a wrathful God. That's not worthy of him. Well, is it because such thoughts are unworthy of God that you have this problem? Or unworthy of your own self-dignity? Is it reason that's keeping you away, or is it pride that keeps you from looking to the cross? There upon the cross is the King of Glory who humbled himself for you. Or is it pain that holds you back? Perhaps you've lost a loved one. Perhaps you have suffered, or a loved one has suffered and has been rejected. maybe even at the hands of those who claim to look to the cross, then I bid you all the more to look to the one hanging upon that cross, the one who, as he was being crucified, asked the Father to forgive those crucifying him. I bid you to look and to listen to the one who said, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Whatever burden you may carry, whatever burden you have told yourself that, I can handle this, or you've tried to convince yourself that, hey, I put the past aside, whatever that burden may be, give to the one who hung upon the cross precisely to place that burden upon himself and to give you rest. We give you praise, our God, for our Lord Jesus Christ, who did all the work on our behalf, who bore our burdens, who bore that debt of our sins upon his own shoulders on that cross. Brother, all the more as we look upon that cross, may we understand sin for what it is. May we all the more understand holiness and righteousness. May we all the more seek to sound the depth of such love and mercy given for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.